JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for September the 29th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, head of research here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded mixed against the other major currencies on Monday and during the Asian session Tuesday. It gained versus JPY, the Euro, and CHF in that order, while it underperformed against AUD, GBP, and CAD. The greenback was found virtually unchanged against NZD. The weakening of the yen and franc, combined with the strengthening of the risk-linked Aussie and loonie, suggests that financial markets may have traded in a risk-on manner yesterday and today in Asia. Indeed, major EU indices finished their session in positive territory yesterday, perhaps due to the absence of new negative headlines surrounding China's Evergrande. However, the picture was different during the US session. The Dow Jones gained somewhat, but the S&P 500 and the Nasdaq traded lower, dragged by tech stocks, which slid due to rising treasury yields. Remember that high growth stocks are valued based on discounted estimated future cash flows, and thus rising interest rates result in a lower present value. Today in Asia, sentiment was more mixed. Japan's Nikkei 225 and South Korea's KOSPI slid, but China's Shanghai Composite and Hong Kong's Hang Seng edged north. Now, today, although we don't have any major indicators on the schedule, we do have several central bank policymakers to hear from, remarks of whom may reshape market expectations around monetary policy. In the Eurozone, ECB's forum on central banking will start today, and the speaker's agenda includes Fed Chief Jerome Powell, Bank of England Governor Andrew Bailey, and Bank of Japan Governor Haruhiko Kuroda. They probably speak tomorrow, but we will stay alert on any early comments today. Other policymakers are also scheduled to speak throughout the week. On top of that, Fed Chair Powell will testify before the US Congress on the Fed's policy response to the pandemic. He will speak before the Senate Banking Committee today, while tomorrow he will present the same testimony before the House Financial Services Committee. Last week, the Fed confirmed that quantitative easing tapering is likely to start this year, with investors hoping that this will happen as early as in November. Thus, remarks adding credence to that view may result in further dollar buying. Having said that, though, yesterday Fed members Brainard and Evans highlighted the importance of the labor market in taking a tapering decision. Therefore, whether or not the Fed will taper in November may also depend by the September employment report, scheduled to be released next Friday. Now in the UK, the Bank of England appeared more hawkish than expected, encouraging market participants to bring forth their rate hike expectations. Therefore, it would be interesting to see whether we will get any hints on when the first hike may take place. According to the latest data on the forward curve of the UK overnight index swaps, the market is pricing in a 15 basis point hike, meaning from the current 0.10% to 0.25%, to be delivered in March 2022. So anything suggesting that this may happen earlier could support the British pound, especially against currencies the central bank of which are forecast to stay accommodative for longer, the likes of the euro, the Aussie and the yen. That said, the Aussie and the yen are more sensitive to developments surrounding the broader market sentiment, thus we would prefer to study them against each other, as when market sentiment improves or the yen marches higher, while the opposite is usually true when risk appetite deteriorates. Indeed, yesterday, when appetite improved, OZN was the best performing cross consisting of major currencies. Now, with regards to the ECB, officials of this bank announced a moderately lower pace in its pandemic emergency purchase program purchases, but made it clear that this is not a tapering move, and that when PEP is over, they have all the other tools available. So with that in mind, we will look for any comments as to whether the ECB tends to compensate, let's say, the lower pace in PEP by buying through other schemes like the asset purchase program. It could compensate when PEP is over, and the date for PEP to over is, I think, March 2022. So this will keep the ECB near the dovish end of the central bank spectrum and may result in some more euro selling, at least against the US dollar, if indeed Fed policymakers are willing to start tapering in November and sound more hawkish on interest rates. Now, as far as the Bank of Japan is concerned, there is not much to anticipate, as Japanese policymakers have been stuck with extra loose monetary policy, showing no intention to proceed with any changes anytime soon. Now, as for the rest of today's events, the only data releases worth mentioning are the US Conference Board Consumer Confidence Index for September, which is expected to have risen to 114.5 from 113.8, as well as the American Petroleum Institute report on crude oil inventories for last week. But as it is always the case, no forecast is available. Tonight, or better say tomorrow in Asia, we have the leadership elections of Japan's ruling Liberal Democratic Party, the winner of which will succeed Suga as a prime minister as well. However, he may not hold that position for long, as national elections will take place on or before November 28th. Taro Kano appears to be the favorite, a candidate that supports a spending package that focuses on boosting wages and growth. However, we don't expect Japanese markets to react massively on the outcome. Remember that in the days after Suga's announcement that he will step down, Japan's Nikkei 225 surged almost 12%, suggesting that investors have already cheered the prospect of better days with a new prime minister. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.